They're playing basketball
all around the world.
We are the basketball
to the beach.
They're playing basketball.
Let's go. All around the world. Y'all know this is so dead.
Favorite sport.
Uh-huh.
I like the way they dribble up and down the court.
Come on.
I keep it so fresh on the microphone. I like no interruption when the game is on.
Game's on.
I like slam dunk to take me to the hoop.
Yeah.
My favorite play is the alley-oop. Uh-huh. I like the pick and roll.
Go.
I like the give and go. And it's basketball. Bow wow. Let's go.
Spring has sprung, so welcome to the BEBC
BS
Podcast. And guys, this is episode number 25.
Are we still counting?
We are counting. We will count until we can't count anymore, until we run out of fingers and toes.
The FCC shuts us down before we get to 50.
You think so?
Probably.
I'm shocked they haven't shut us down yet already.
We just had a joke that y'all won't know about until we tell you who we have with us tonight, and then it'll be very funny.
Special guests.
We do have special guests tonight, and we couldn't be happier to have with us tonight the coaching staff from the 6A state champion Allen Eagles basketball team.
Yeah.
Woo!
Sounds good.
They're here. Believe it or not, we got all four of them here.
We suckered them into this.
We have.
We bribed them with jelly beans.
Promised jelly beans.
That's all it took. So anybody wanting to get a guest appearance by these guys, just get the right jelly beans.
Starburst.
Sour.
Gotta be sour or they will turn around and leave. So, Jeff, Joe, Drew, John, thanks, guys. We appreciate you being here.
Thanks for having us.
And congratulations.
Yeah, thank
you. We have never had state champion coaches here at the clubhouse.
History
so,
maker.
We're excited.
Oh, yeah. History
oh, oh, groundbreaking.
And the other thing y'all don't know is, well, this table is new since our last podcast.
You're breaking
this,
it in.
This is the Virgin
Voyage. Yes. The chairs you're sitting in, as you know, are brand new. We upgraded because we knew we were having big time
royalty.
Yeah,
royalty.
Went all out for us.
We did. So
we even got a silver Sharpie to sign your name on this table.
We did. You know, I'm going to get one
of
those.
Not a bad idea.
Those Randy Bridges posters. Have you seen those that have all the scores? So we'll get we'll get these guys to sign that. It'll go right up there on the wall because it'll be, you know, first state championship team from Allen. So. Have you come down off your high yet?
It has been hard to do, you know, especially with that week of spring break where we had a little bit of free time to, you know, relax a little bit and just soak it all in. And I still have a few blackout moments from the whole thing, or it was just a blur. And I've seen myself make a complete idiot of myself on just about every social media outlet and news station there are, but
hey, it was a great finger roll you had.
You fit in, making yourself look like an idiot. You fit in with this.
Hit rewinding the part where he's running down the sideline. Now there,
there was high stepping going on there.
There was a little bit of everything. There was some 40s. I wanted to show off all the skills, the vertical.
Was sweet
with the high step.
I thought you were being a little aggressive, giving yourself a 4.29 on the 40. That was more of a 4.25.
I was watching it fast forward a few times, maybe instead of regular speed. But you know, just an amazing weekend and. Awesome for our kids to have that experience, and these guys with me here today did an amazing job preparing our kids, getting our kids ready for that moment, and not that we just won it, but how we won it and who we won it against. You know, I had one of the football coaches come up to me and say on Monday morning this week when we returned that the way we did it and how we did it and who we did it against was probably more impressive than any state title they've ever won, which is a huge compliment coming from those guys because they do it a lot. So just pretty neat. Unfortunately, I had to come back down to reality this week when we returned to school and get back to work and pat them all on the back on Monday and tell them great job. And then we turned it around to the young guys and said, that's in the past. It doesn't matter anymore.
Yeah,
you got a big target on your back. So let's go for 2019.
There you go.
I think the coolest part was Monday coming into school. You know, we had the week off, and, you know, there was all that kind of euphoria and joy and celebration that we all kind of went through last weekend. And when we came back to school on Monday, a week later, it kind of turned into pride. And all of our guys were wearing their medals to class. And and it was just really cool. With, you know, when 2:30 the bell rang and all those guys came down into the gym, because I don't see them in the hallway all day, every day, because I teach over at Lowry. But when I got over there, I made sure and got down there and watched them kind of come in the door. And every one of them, you could just, they had this sense of accomplishment and pride. And it kind of had morphed from, like I said, that celebration and joy to a sense of accomplishment and pride. And it was really neat to see as those kids walked in, because they knew what they had done. It wasn't easy. And we
I mean, still. That was a hell of a run, man.
Yeah. I printed out the schedule for the year, because I went back and I wanted to talk about sort of the year and as it went, and to get y'all's thoughts on, as you're progressing through the season, at what point did you say, or at what point did you go, I don't know? Because I can tell you some of these games, and it
was ugly.
In my mind, I was like, man, what's happening down there, you know? And it's just like, what is going on? But you go back through the season and you look, you know, and the first game I went to, and there were a couple of us there, was the West Mesquite game, you know, which was early in the year, and obviously a 5A school, and that turned into such a big blowout. We were like, wow, this is impressive. You know, everybody playing, you scored 118 points, and you're like,
41 points in the first quarter?
Yeah, it was very good memory. That's a numbers man right there. I like it.
Brain like a sieve.
Yeah. Awesome. And you're like,
we were all looking at the scoreboard going,
dang. Yeah, it's like, these guys can.
We were too.
Yeah, I know. Well, that's good to know, because I guess until you get out there and you do it, you really don't know what you kind of know what you have, but until you have competition other than each other, you know, what do you have? And so that, you know, that went well, and then, you know, you did well, and then you went down to Pasadena and you ran into Duncanville. And I know none of us were there because football, dadgummit, keeps running long, you know, for the last 6 years. Football has interrupted basketball season, but you go down there and you lose, I guess, a heartbreaker. I guess you lost at the buzzer to Duncanville.
Correct.
And, you know, you played well the rest of the time, but you lose to Duncanville. And Duncanville was a state-ranked team. Yes. And so, you know, you're, what, 6 games in and you're 5-1. And so at that point, what are any of your thoughts about what you got?
I feel like at that point, I think coming back from Houston, we preach growth a lot during the season, especially, you know, leading into February. We're not real concerned about wins and losses in November, December.
It's unlike us.
Yeah.
And unlike parents.
We're more concerned about growth. So did we grow that game? Did we not grow that game? And I feel like when we came back from Houston, I think all of us kind of felt like, well, we definitely got better, and we're definitely better than we were 6 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, whatever. And we were excited about where things were going. And I think all along, even in the preseason, we knew we had pieces to be able to have a great season. I don't know that anybody was saying, okay, we've got the pieces to where we needed to win a state title. But we knew we had good chemistry, good pieces, and we were just concentrating on getting better. And at that point, I think we were.
Well, from a fan's perspective, though, like, I get to see different games, and it would be, what would be cool is there was always one, at least one person, you know, y'all had 4 kids that I know, the 2 Jalen's and Brenton and Jarrett, that all been, what, since sophomores, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it was, you know, and other guys too, but it seemed like there was one guy that could step up and make that bucket, you know, to get a run going. Mm-hmm. And it'd be a different guy each time. That was what was interesting from, because in years past, you know, everybody remembers Cam, everybody remembers Nick Rutherford and OC3. Those guys, you know, they were highly touted and depended on. But this group seemed like you never knew who that guy was going to be. You look at the stat line, it could be 1 of 5 guys that led the team in scoring. And that was what I thought was interesting about this team.
And I think when we went into the season as coaches, we felt like our starting 5 was potentially way – and we had a pretty good offensive group last year and the last couple of years. But we felt like this was probably our best offensive starting 5 we've had. Now, we had some question marks about defense, We weren't sure how we were ever going to get a rebound with some of the midgets out there, with some of the people on our schedule. So that was a challenge a little bit for us going into it. But we also knew that when one of those guys had an off night, it wasn't a big deal because somebody else was going to pick up the slack. One of those starting five were going to do that. And every night it was somebody different. And people that watched us and coaches that watched us, I think it was a nightmare for them because it's like, who do you try to take away? Because it doesn't really matter. If you take one guy away, there's somebody else there that can knock. And they could all knock down shots and all could score. And, you know, we came out that way. And going back to the West Mesquite game, I think every year as a head coach you have an idea of who you're going to be. But that first game is probably the most nerve-wracking game of the year because you think you got something. Right. But until you roll that ball out there the very first time, you're not sure. Yeah. We found out pretty quick we can score the basketball and we can defend a little bit. Obviously, you know, the competition had something to do with it. They were a 5A program with some football guys that they had for one – I think that was their first day out there. Yeah. Right. That definitely showed up in that game. But, you know, we did roll into the Houston tournament down in Pasadena there and always great competition in that. You get to see a lot of different styles against a lot of teams that are traditional basketball powerhouses. They get invited there because they can play and they're doing something right. And even when they have down years, the name on their chest still means something.
Right.
And they don't have down years. You know, a down year is winning 24 or 25 games. So we knew going into that we were going to see something. And we found out some about ourselves. Not really geared to our style, because in that tournament, you end up playing 5 games in 3 days. And we like to try to usually play fast pace, up and down, get after you, defensive. I know we're probably going to talk about that a little later, our style. But early in the year, our philosophy has always been to play a lot of guys, get guys ready, because at some point in the season, you're going to have guys ready. And I showed up during our holiday tournament. You got to get some of those young guys ready. You can't just rely on 5 guys. So we may take a loss early in the year to develop our bench and to get them some quality minutes and to do some things. And, you know, we're down in Pasadena, we play a lot more guys because of 5 games in 3 days, especially that early in the season. And then for us, one of our biggest things and advantages, I think that these guys around me do just better than anybody else in the state, is preparing and doing their homework when you give us some time to do that. And down there, we never even got to watch Duncanville because they played the same. You play at the same time as your opponent every time. So you have no idea what you're about to see. Right. You just go in and you just play. But as the season goes on, you get in district play, you're allowed to game plan a little bit. We'll talk about maybe some of that a little bit. We'll talk about some of our opponents. But we've always been of the mindset that we want to have – I don't care who we are in November, December. We just got to be good enough in January and February. But that end of February, March is when we want to be great. And we've been pretty darn good, I think. In the last 5 years, 19 playoff wins, which I think is the second most of any 5A.
Second most of any 5A or 6A program.
In the state.
Yeah, I remember you talking about the playoff runs y'all made. And last year, one of my coworkers, his son played at Keller. And so that kid, RJ, that is at TCU. I mean, he was playing out of his mind that put us out last year. I mean, you know, one or two buckets away from going again to the Final Four last year. So,
and that, I think that loss, you talk about the Duncanville loss we had here, and I think you'll see as you go down and look at some of our losses, you look through our schedule, having a group of 9 seniors, that, you know, sometimes a loss like that, a late season loss or a late game loss like that can cause you to kind of second guess yourself, have your kids kind of hang their heads. But you'll see that our guys use that as fuel. You know, we talked about how the teams we lost to, all but one of them, we got a chance to play again. And that was, kind of called it.
Yeah.
We
were really kind of hoping a little bit. They're really good. I don't know. We maybe not wanted them.
I didn't hang 43 again.
Yeah, I was having to coach the defense.
As long as we had 2 more points than them, we would have been fine with it. But it would have been just kind of a cherry on top if we would have got South Carolina and were able to beat them, just to say, hey, we avenged every single loss.
Right. But the mindset of our guys was allowed us to, you know, to use those losses as motivation. You know, and they're, like I said, they're a veteran group of guys. And even going back to Keller last year, we talked about that kind of being our starting point for this year, was that Keller loss last year.
And speaking of South Garland, you know, you lose to Duncanville, you come back, you win 6 straight after that. Okay. And you're playing over, I guess, in the Garland tournament then. and you
got some momentum.
Yeah, and then you have you get up against South Garland, and that honestly was, I'm going to confess here, that was the next game I got to see.
Yeah.
And
I saw you on film.
Yeah. And James and I and Alan went.
Did you see the first two quarters?
We did.
Yes. That was good stuff.
And it was amazing. And again, we're sitting there going, well, actually through three quarters was pretty good.
Yeah.
And then
two and a half.
Yeah.
So what happened?
But it's a South Garland team that's ranked, what, third or fourth in the state at that point. I mean, they're ranked pretty high. And they've got, you know, obviously – his name just escaped me.
Maxie.
Harris. He's unbelievable. I mean, he was really good in the tournament run that they had. Just watching him, he's the best player
in the state.
You know, he's crazy good. And you had him, you held him first half, you held him in check. And then the second half, he got warmed up a little bit. But, yeah.
Just a little.
Yeah. And it's still a close game. And you were very competitive for the most part. But, yeah, things did, in our minds, unravel a little bit there in the latter part of the third and the fourth quarter, and you're like, heck, you had this game. But what I find, and we'll go back to that game, but what I find most impressive about that was you went out the next week and you beat DeSoto at their place after that loss to South Garland. And so what did you learn, you know, from the South Garland game that helped you when you stepped up next week and had to go down to DeSoto and play, because they're very good too?
I think it was that anonymous nasty email that was probably sent by you now that really motivated us.
Mark has no anonymity. He's up front.
He'll put his name to it.
Yeah. It might have been signed by the BEBC.
Fake news.
I think our kids, just the way we kind of fell apart, I think got caught up in the officiating and the things that don't matter, and we didn't control what we can control, or we got caught up in all the other stuff. And you know, as a team with a lot of experience, we should have been the ones that kind of stepped it up in that game and not so much South Garland. So I think our kids were sick after that. But once again, having nine seniors and some veteran guys, and we didn't go in and lose it as coaches. We said, hey, look, you know, it's an opportunity to get better. We don't care where we're at. Once again, in November and December, what matters is where we're at in February and March.
I will say something stuck with me, and I shared with our kids our film session that next day. I guess it was Monday. So Maxie comes to our bench at the end of the game, and he's not shy. And he looked at our kids, and he said, I thought y'all were supposed to be good.
Oh.
And so, you know, as we showed film on Monday,
he had a few more choice words for us.
Well, but that was the
what he's saying now.
Yeah, that was the, you know, and of course we as coaches can just kind of smile and nod, but that was the kind of carrot we were able to hold during film session on Monday. You know, hey, this guy just came to y'all's bench and said this, and here's how we played, and you know, we looked at ourselves defensively. And from an offensive standpoint, that was the first time all year, I think you'll probably agree, that we had a team that got after us and challenged us and went, basically switched everything, which we're not a team you can switch very many things against, and just challenged us and got after us in the second half, and we folded. And so we had to get better offensively and tougher, and I think we did. I think that game helped us so much.
Yeah, we don't beat Ellison. Probably
we don't beat Duncanville.
Probably Duncanville in the playoffs if we don't have that game as a chance to get better.
It's also a game when, you know, we wish the kids would have done some stuff different, but we sat down as coaches and go, man, we got to have an answer for this.
Yeah.
We got to have an answer late for this. We got to have somebody else that's the trail guy. We got to have somebody else there that can shoot free throws. We got to have somebody else here that can handle pressure, because we got to be able to move our parts around a little bit better, and we didn't do that in that game. And so – it was a learning experience for us, and as coaches, it was a learning experience for our kids. And we went back and we watched the film and said, hey, here's – and we always
– with extra motivation.
With a loss, we always – I mean, I'm a firm believer. We always take the responsibility as a coach and say, hey, it's on me. You know, I didn't have you guys ready, but we're going to be ready next time. And we have a few extra motivational drills some week in practice, what I like to call them, or whatever it takes, a little motivational film session. But our kids respond. Like you said, a sign of a great team is when you play bad, how are you going to respond? And man, did we respond in a big way? And that was a scary game to go into, because DeSoto had just lost their first game, I think, and they lost a game they probably shouldn't have as well. And you're walking into their place where they
don't lose.
Don't lose.
Control it. Yeah.
They don't lose. They don't lose
much anyway, but they definitely don't lose there. And we totally frustrated probably one of the most revered coaches in the state and one of the most revered teams in front of their home fans. And to my knowledge, is the worst loss that's ever happened in that arena.
God, they hate us so bad.
Y'all are just piling on with football dust to
everybody's
them, you know?
Got to have a nemesis. Yeah. And we're DeSoto's nemesis.
Well, I think it's hats off to the kids, too, with that. Because that, if you remember, that was the first game where we said, okay, we're going to start preparing like we do for district and everything.
Yeah.
That was the first game that we did a true scouting report for. And they bought in because they didn't like that feeling after that South Garland game. So they took that scouting report, and, I mean, they executed it extremely well.
We treated that like a kind of a playoff game scout.
Stress rehearsal.
Yeah. And getting ready for district. We do it in district, but this was a little bit more like a playoff game because we knew we were going to get them, and so we'd been scouting them for several weeks, you know, when they came up here to play in a tournament. So we had some – you know, some stuff for them, and our kids executed. You're right.
Yeah, you got them. I mean, 23-point win was significant.
Yeah, it's a statement.
I'll be honest, when I got the paper the next morning, I don't even know if I saw on Twitter or not. Before, when you get the paper, you're like, holy cow. You know, I should have gone to that game and not saw the South Garland game. But, you know.
Now we know what our real problem was.
Exactly. Well, hey, we'll get into that also. Yeah. Having to do with free throws. But yeah. That's a whole other thing.
So, and you win DeSoto, you have two more games. Heber and Plano, you win. You start district with Plano. You beat them. Plano, obviously, is Plano and will always be Plano. And then Geyer comes rolling into town. We doubt Plano.
We love Plano.
He's the one coach in this district that doesn't put up with our shenanigans at all. He does not like us. No, not the Plano coach.
Oh, the Plano coach.
No, okay. I don't even know his name.
We're talking Plano West coach. Yeah. Dean. We have a good time with
him. He does not like us at all, and that's okay. But anyhow. Geyer rolls in. First Geyer game. And it's a very competitive game. And
it was a hell of a game.
Yeah.
Minus our starting point guard.
Right.
Yep.
No excuses.
Yeah.
But and it was about to the last 2 minutes. I think it was tied. If my memory serves me correct. Y'all can correct me if I'm wrong, but it was 70 in the 70s. It was close. And
we had three offensive possessions in a row with a chance to take the lead.
Yep.
And we did not.
Turned it over.
Over.
Yep. Yep.
At home, which always stings a little
bit.
Probably
missed our point guard in the last minute or two.
Yeah.
Or that depth there.
And they're a heck of a team. I mean, good Lord. And
maybe better than a heck of a team.
Yeah. I mean, because we've talked a lot about ourselves, and we go back to the – and again –
yeah, because we're a pretty good team.
Yeah, we're, you know, our basketball knowledge isn't y'all's, but we go back and kind of compared them a little bit. I think they're better than the Plano West teams of a couple of years ago with the amount of talent that they had on the team. Yeah. But agreed. I thought together they were a much better team. You know, to me they were more athletic, even though that Plano West team's pretty athletic and you see those guys in the tournament still right now. But I always thought that Geyer team was better. So I was encouraged by the fact we played with them and it really had an opportunity to win
that first game.
And then you go, okay, here we are in the last 2 minutes again, and doggone it, you know, you walk away disappointed. I know y'all were, and I know the kids probably were.
Yeah, that's a home game in district that you're going against the, you know, everybody, we were the two front runners for the district, and we lose at home, and that, you know, that makes it tough. So that was very disappointing to the kids. But I think we learned some things in that game that a lot of people probably don't realize we learned. That we're able to use later, you know.
Yeah, well, so. that one's coming. Yeah, that conversation's still coming. But there's one game between all of that I really want to talk. And to me, it was your worst game of the year.
It was a turning point.
Did you just skip over that one?
No. So you know what I'm talking about, don't you?
Yeah.
I walk up the stands, and you guys are sitting at the top of the stands. How's it going?
Not good.
Had a worst week of practice ever.
So and if that really was what happened, it showed that night. And for those of you who don't know, we're talking about the away game at McKinney.
And capital U.
Okay. What happened?
Tried to erase that one from my memory. Thanks for bringing that one.
But it's okay.
Don't worry. We're going to praise you later.
State championship to fall back on. So, you know.
Yeah, you got to take the good with the bad in this group, brother.
It was ugly. It was embarrassing. You know, you talk all the time about stylistically good matchups for you, bad matchups for you. And McKinney, for whatever reason, has always been a tough one for us, just what they do and how they do it and systematically some things they do. But That was the game where Stevens had been out since before Christmas with the ankle. And probably looking back, we overplayed him that game. Dixon had come off having the flu and didn't play in that tournament. With the 5 days we take off plus being off, we probably pushed him too much that week. And then it was just, I hate being out of routine. And we had that full week off out of school where I'm sure all our guys stayed up too late and tried to sleep in too much. And there's something to be said about routine of when, I like to, when we play games, I like for them always to be at 6 and 7:30, JV at 6, varsity 7:30. I don't like playing afternoon games. I don't like playing a 9:30 tip-off in the state championship. I don't like it, but I don't like the holidays because everything is, there's nothing routine about it, and the practices, everything for the kids, just how they handle themselves through the weekend. We had a terrible week of practice, and probably the one time all year long that our kids didn't respond. You talk about learning lessons, and it was probably the best thing that happened to us all year long was that we went out there and looked like the total garbage that we were that night and just got abused by McKinney, out-hustled, out-efforted. I mean, it was ridiculous. It was hard for me to watch.
You had a lot of energy at the end of that game. Yeah. I'll just say that.
You were fired up. But that's a whole that's a whole different thing.
Don't feed that beast.
It was a week's worth of frustration.
Yeah, I had a moment to right come there. Out, apologize to the guy afterwards. He was wrong. I was right. I would say that. But I probably wasn't right with how I, let my frustration boil over onto him.
Oh, we'd like to see a little bit of emotion.
My wife, the only reason she comes to the games is to see me get a technical. She'll tell you straight up. She's like, you never show any emotion at home. And, I love it when you get a technical.
Have you ever been tossed in the game?
I
want to hear the answer to this.
I did head home early one night.
Frisco Centennial, I believe.
No, I was at Frisco High School in the tournament. I was versus a team out of Oklahoma. And
well, that answers that. Says a lot.
They showed up about 25 minutes late, and we played the game after we'd sat there for like 45 minutes doing warm-ups. And so it was frustrating already. We had a bad officiating crew that night. And I had a really young team that year. So during free throws, I mean, I had like two freshmen and some sophomores. I had several football kids when I was in Sherman. And during free throws, I would have all four of my guys come over and huddle up while we were shooting free throws. Because I had to coach them every single second because they were so young, so inexperienced. So, like, we used every free throw as a timeout, and the ref didn't like that. And so he told us, during a free throw situation, there's a guy that fouls out, and I pull my shooter off the line, and I'm talking to him, and they subbed a guy in pretty quick, and the ref just puts the ball down on the free throw line. And starts the count. Well, my guy goes in, picks it up, shoots it. And then afterwards, their coach yells, that's a violation. And so the ref blows his whistle. If it was a violation, it would have been when he walked in. Mm-hmm. And I think technically it was. He shouldn't have put the ball down. But he let the other coach make the call, and then he called it. And then I told him what I went to. At that point, I went to get a motivational technical for our team.
You over-motivated,
did you?
And apparently, he thought it was too much motivation and gave me not one but two T's and sent me to the house, which was a humbling experience, to say the least. Steve Spey was the coach at Frisco at the time running the tournament, and so he consoled me there for a while and brought me a diet drink and told me it'll be all right. And he had a few choice words for what happened out there as well, so he agreed with me.
Positive side, though, the next Tuesday night, I got my first win as a head coach. So that worked out. You know.
Save me a drive to Oklahoma.
There you go.
I stay home and spend a little time with my wife that night. So.
Did you show any emotion?
She likes for me to bring the unsportsmanlike conduct home. Yeah.
He was very technical.
Oh, my gosh. Well, anyhow, yeah, McKinney, we were all just shaking our heads. I don't remember who was there. You were there.
Who else was there? David was there. I was there.
Were you there? And Alan was there.
Whoever was there probably didn't come back again.
It was not.
But the great thing about that game is we didn't have to say anything. The kids knew.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I mean.
Especially after we saw the film the next morning.
And he said a few things, too. So.
But I mean, the kids knew what they needed to do.
Well, I
mean,
I almost didn't come back because I had now been to 4 games and 3 of them you had lost. And I'm like, it must be me.
Once again. Yeah. The truth comes out. Yeah.
It's like, I'm going to quit going.
So when did the commentary jinx start on the free throws?
Oh, that was in the playoffs. Stop. We'll get to that.
Okay. Yeah. But
Geyer.
A general question. This team seems to have been really, really proficient at free throws and making. Is that an accurate observation? Or?
Seemed like that until the end of a couple of games. I mean, yeah. We had 2 guys that are career 80-85% free throw shooting, which in high school is phenomenal. Yeah. I think we finished the season with 4 of the starters over 70%, which is pretty impressive.
And the 5th starter was right at 70%.
Yeah, he was just right below, I think. So
we didn't have any weak links.
No, there wasn't one guy that you just knew was going to go up there and I'll go ahead and throw him under the bus. Jermoney McNeese said,
yeah, no hack of
Jermoney. Hey, Jermoney,
he had a little trouble with his free throws.
Dude, he still has trouble.
Well, he didn't get to go to the line much.
So you roll through district, and it comes back up to game number 2 versus Geyer. And a bunch of us went up there, and a bunch of Allen people. The place was packed. It was a great environment.
Packed with Geyer folks, man.
And
there was several people from other schools and stuff.
Yeah, it was the game of the week.
It was.
For sure.
And I'm just going to say, you got run out of the gym. Now, I've learned since then that we might have a Mark Cuban tank situation here. That's what I'm going to call it.
Sucker.
There was no tank.
There was no tank. We never throw a game.
I know
we
that.
We went in with 2 our kids that week, and we said, look, if we beat Geyer, nobody else is going to beat Geyer. They're going to be a 1-loss team. They've won district. I mean, that's the reality. No matter what happens in this game, they've won district. We're second place, best case scenario. And they knew we kind of found some nuggets there in game 1 of things that we felt like we could do. And we told our kids, we're not going to run a single thing this game. We're just going to go up and down, do what we call flow, which is just our base stuff. We're going to run 1 inbound play, and we're going to see if they show a few of their cards of things they're willing to change and do. And we figured out pretty quick when we went in there and they decided to honor every single person and didn't in pregame. They were going all in on that game.
Yep.
And you know what? We were going to find out 1 of 2 things. Number 1, are our kids just good enough and better? Or are we going to have some ammo to walk in and tell our kids? Because we felt all along like we had a chance to be in that regional tournament game. We were going to have to play well in the playoffs because Region 1 is absolutely loaded. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's not the rest of the state has no idea how easy they've got it.
That sounds familiar.
Yeah.
But we had an idea as coaches already of what we wanted to have accomplished. There were some things we had to iron out and recalls within that system of how we were going to make that happen. But we went out and probably – it was the best thing that could happen to us. And I think their heads got a little big. And I think everybody at that point in time wrote us off. And we got to fly under the radar the rest of the way. And we had a plan for what was going to happen later. And they had no idea what was coming.
And in watching that game, I went back to watch it as we were preparing for Geyer, the scouting report. You know, we played really well for probably
almost the first
3 quarters of the game. There was the first half we played great. We were right there with them, had led most of the game, had a couple of turnovers, and they scored in the last minute. But we came out in the third quarter, and really about 4 to 5 minutes of the third quarter, we really just didn't match their pace. But then, you know, we finished off okay, but they just kind of blew it out to about a 15-point lead in that stretch. So, you know, we weren't as bad as it looked, but it was – again, it was a chance for us to have a little bit of an edge. And we didn't show any of our cards. And they showed a couple of things of how they were going to defend us a little bit that we felt like we could use. And, you know, it's just a chance for us to use as a learning experience as we were hoping to see them again.
Mm-hmm.
We weren't as bad as the score indicated that night.
So from that game, y'all decided to go into that third game with them to do the stall?
No, we didn't decide to stall.
Patience.
Well, even then, we weren't
control the tempo.
Yeah, let's hang on. I want to get to that. But yeah, I'm just going to request, and we're we're nobodies, but next time you decide to do that, let us know beforehand. Yeah. We won't tell anybody. But that was a hard watch, and it was even harder because sitting right next to us was Coach Long's wife and his mom and his dad. And it was like,
it was great for the first half.
Yeah, because we were all over yelling.
Talking about at Denton.
At Denton, yeah.
And then we just had to sit there quiet for the rest of the game.
He's great. By the way, he is our favorite. He's embraced us, and he talks to us.
Next to the Plano West coach.
He's awesome.
Grant and I have a great relationship. Yeah.
He seems to be a good dude.
I was elated when we won that game, but it was hard because of such respect for a colleague across the way. He and I, I'm the president of the North Texas Basketball Coach Association. He is the vice president. Yeah. We work together and do a lot of stuff to try to help promote the game of basketball in this area. And so a lot of respect for what he's done over there. And just the way, and he was amazing. He texted me several times the next day in that coming week about just so many positive things to say about our staff and our kids. And, you know, I think he was a little bitter still that we did what we did. But
we'll tell you about our interaction with him after the game. We'll tell you how bitter he was. Okay, so playoffs. All right, you lose to Guyer, and then you run the table in district. In fact, January 26th was the Guyer game, and that was the last loss of the season. So you run the table in district, and you playoffs come. Trinity, you know, that was what it was. That was a sub-500 team, I think, that you were playing. They were horrible in non-district. And then you come back to Duncanville. And so when you look at that, I mean, looking back, when you look at all those teams you played in the playoffs, which one of those, I hate to say the word fear, or which do you think was going to be the biggest challenge?
The toughest matchup.
Yeah.
I think obviously with Guyer, you know, four losses in a row to them and just the total matchup thing and rebounding thing, which we thought from day one was a problem. I had to, you know, had some fear in us, but the thing that gave us some trouble and teams that we really struggle with are teams that can match our quickness and athleticism, even maybe surpass it, especially on the defensive end. I think Duncanville and South Garland were those two teams during the year that really, Colleen Ellison showed it a little bit in the playoffs as well on the defensive end. You know, those teams, and Duncanville's a program that expects to win. They're one of those that, when they put on their jersey, it's worth 10 more points and 10 more wins a season just because it says it on their chest.
Yep.
And, you know, they gave us some trouble the first go around. We didn't have time to prepare, so we felt a little more positive going into this one. But we were also asking a lot of question marks because of the whole DeSoto-Duncanville end-of-season fiasco that we had a lot of question marks when we were doing our scouting report. We thought we had this. We thought we had that. But we weren't even sure who was going to roll out there and play for them, how they were going to handle suspend. How many of those guys were suspended for the season, how many were suspended for a game, how many were – you know, and so there was, and so we got thrown a little bit of a curveball there. I think with their starting lineup, they didn't play their bigs. Like they recognized from the get go, we're not going to play our bigs. And the game before that, they had played two bigs the whole game.
Yeah.
And,
well, they had played a big on the floor almost the entire year,
and sometimes two.
So that was tough. But I mean, to answer your question, there's nobody close to Guyer in terms of who we were. I mean, I don't know if he's trying to be nice or whatever, but I mean, Duncanville, South Garland's teams, yeah, we respect the crap out of those guys, but Guyer, I mean, that was
it's a whole different beast.
Yeah, and I mean, me from an offensive perspective, every single game we played in the playoffs that I'm looking at, okay, how can we attack? I'm like doing like 90% how can we attack Duncanville, Trinity, Ellison, and then I'm 10% okay, what if we play Guyer? Because it's just like we knew we had to do something perfect if we were going to end up playing them. Like, I mean, we had to be perfect in whatever we decided to do. And we'd started throwing some things around and things like that. But, you know, there was nobody close in terms of Goliath.
Sure.
You know, I agree with you. They are a better, more complete team than the West team was.
Because they got a point guard. They
play harder.
Yeah.
They're a point guard and they play harder.
Yeah.
They're more disciplined.
That, yeah.
Well, I was going to – the one game that I only got to see in person, playoff game, was the Colleen Ellison game. And it was interesting to see and hear – I don't know if y'all could hear the fans kind of start a roar come up as we start to work the ball into the post, out of the post, reverse it, and, you know, get 12 passes on a possession. And what was the first – that we held the ball – No. It was before Ellison got a shot in the second half. It was, 5 minutes left to go in the in the third quarter. Yeah, they didn't get a shot. I think it was the fourth quarter
because I watched a little bit today.
Yeah, it was like three minutes.
We took the ball out of a timeout, and they didn't touch it again until there was 5-something left on the clock. And they were kind of in the game because it was about an 8-point game, but we scored, I believe, and made it a double digit game. And really, our kids. That's when I think the belief and the confidence in some things clicked with our kids because, you know, that's a hard thing to do, but then when you are able to do it, and then you finish a back cut. I think Donnie Parham got a back cut. Yep.
And what he means by some things is that specific scheme. That's when they bought into that specific scheme we can move the ball for a while and wear out a defense and
get
we
a
can
great
be good
look.
At
yeah,
it.
That was a great look.
When did they buy in?
It's totally demoralizing when they shoot that layup after
that
2 minutes.
That game was when they bought in.
And then, you know, you see – they were just the opposite. They dribbled the ball around one-on-one type. And I'm not going to say your guys can relax, of course, but it's not like the pressure of giving up that back cut. Nobody wants to overextend on the wing and see their guy go behind them, you know, and alley-oop it to Brent and see a dunk and, you know, those types of things that I was like, man, this is going to be key. You know, I'm not a basketball mind of any sort, but I said that scheme would definitely work against Guyer. If you hold the ball, they can't score.
Run up and down I looked at Joe on the bench and I said, hey, this is Guyer. And he said, yeah, you're right.
And
we had the idea against Guyer to expose their bigs with our bigs because we had the quickness with
that's
our
what we were
bigs,
able to do in the first
and game. And that's what we did the first game. But when we were able to do that
in bigs.
Our guards playing in the balance.
Okay, thank you for clarifying. Yeah. I was confused.
And when we were able to combine that aspect with the fact that our kids really bought into, you know, being able to, you know, use clock to get a great look. It's not just using clock. Anybody can use clock and then take a really bad look and it looks stupid.
You're talking about rebounding. Mr. Jalen Scott, I think, got 17 that game, right, Mark?
Yeah, I mean, they were
20 and 17, yeah.
I mean, that was dragging them out from the backboard, and we were getting all sorts of rebounds.
So, not winning.
Don't tell me.
How long have we been talking?
Oh, we just missed all of
the whole thing?
That was going not too
10 long. Minutes and 49 seconds.
Oh. A go, or that's all that's been recorded?
That's all that's been recorded.
We've been going at this for an hour.
Oh, wow.
We're
unbelievable. Now it's all going to heck in a handbasket.
We all have our McKinney's.
Look how close that got to me.
Dadgummit.
What is going on? But the level, we kept looking at the level thing, and it was
picking up.
I looked over, and it wasn't.
It was it froze.
All right. You've got to be kidding me. All right, it means y'all are going to have to come back, and we're going to do it over. That is unreal.
Don't mind. This has been gold. Too bad we didn't get it recorded.
Yeah. Well, it's just a dress rehearsal.
Never mind. I'll edit it out. It just flipped over to the other one. We're good.
Oh, we're good?
The first month. I don't know why I did it. We're been going. We're good. We're it.
Watch it.
Okay. Woo! I was worried. I'll edit that part out.
All right. Take two.
So, I was going to say, we were talking about Clean Ellison, and David brought it up a minute ago, and, you know, at halftime, Matt Welch tweeted that Allen was, I think, 17 for 17 in free throws. And they all had missed a free throw. And so the free throw started, and I missed a free throw, and guess what? Clank. And these guys,
slapped on the head. Man, I've noticed that the whole game. I wasn't going to say anything.
Nope,
I'm a baseball player.
You said it.
Stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I was like.
And that continued almost every game after
I know.
That.
After that, I wouldn't say a word about free throw shooting. I just put my head down every time. So if you had a free throw, you can blame that on me. I did that.
If we're 76.
You were talking at the end of the entire game?
Yeah. No, I was not. So you get by Allison, and North Crowley shows up, and they got that kid that can play.
Yeah, he's all right.
He's all right, too. little drop step back and shoot the three. And, you know, every time you see them, you know, and that's almost like a home game for those guys over there. And,
yeah, most definitely.
And they show up. And by the way, can y'all get that moved?
like a little closer.
Fort Worth is
next year, we'll probably be in Dallas. You know, you can say, hey.
We should be in Dallas next year with Region 2 unless they decide to move it back to Waco or something.
Yeah, that's true. But anyhow, but yeah, Crowley shows up and it's a pretty competitive game too. Well, good team.
I'm going to back up on you a second. Just
you can do that.
I can do it. Thank you. I'm going to go back to Duncanville just because of the
step back three.
Just some of the there was a lot of step back three in that North Crowley. So I'm going to step back before we get to that. I'm going to go back to the Duncanville game for a second. Just some of the things we did. And you guys have been watching us for 6 years now, and we sold our team. This is a team, you know, against Duncanville. We always have a few little wrinkles in there, and our wrinkle was to run a zone, which goes, you know, I hate running zones. I absolutely hate it, but I hate losing a whole lot more. And the way the game started getting called, they started getting to the rim pretty easy, or it was a foul, and we made the adjustment to go zone that we had run to that point in time, like three possessions all year long probably. And it totally baffled them a little bit. We felt like we could probably baffle them after watching them in their first-round playoff game. Just some of the thing, how they attacked a zone against Clean Ellison, right?
Shoemaker. The game before. Shoemaker
in the first round. And so we won that game just being able to switch some things up defensively and just stay gritty. And coach did a great job of game planning. We got several back doors out of some called sets where we knew they were going to overplay some things and stole some baskets that normally are tough to get against them. Then we turned around against Ellison. Ellison was a team that offensively they didn't pass the ball very much because they knew they were going to turn it over. Their best offense was an offensive rebound, and so they were going to get a shot up pretty quick. And we watched some on film, and when the pass was going into the post, all four of the guys would be running. They knew it wasn't coming back out. Mm. They knew the shot was going up, and they were going to go get a board.
Nightmares.
Yeah, I had a hard time sleeping the night before just because that was the thing going into the year that I felt like was our one real Achilles heel was being able to board. And they stayed in that game with some. I mean, they could D you up. They were athletic. A lot of respect for their coach, Alberto Jones. He is the first
water bottle.
He kind of killed his momentum.
He sent me a text right after the game. He said, "Coach, you guys will win it all." And I was like, "Hell, you know, wow. this." I don't know if you've seen some of these other teams.
You seen Geyer?
He said, "No, coach, your guards can keep the ball away." That was kind of the first time that the keep away showed up and that our kids bought into it. And against a really athletic, good defensive team, just totally demoralized them and took them out of being able to do anything. He said, "No, your guards are too good." He goes, "I've seen Guy. You're going to beat him."
Was it Welch? Who was it that commented after that Ellison game and said, watching Alan play keep away is a joy.
Yeah.
It's a joy.
And the thing that really, the crowd was like recognizing, you know, and it just was like with each pass, the clapping got a little louder. Yeah, I don't know if y'all can hear that.
And I will, brilliant. Speaking of the crowd, the Duncanville game was the first game where the crowd really showed up. And it was for even for us, and you know, we're there most of the time, but to get a crowd really involved, you sit back and you watch it in a basketball game. An Allen basketball game, it's cool to finally see that passion, and I know the kids feed off of it.
Making calls in the first half of that game because our kids are on the other end.
Yeah,
I mean, our kids couldn't hear us. We couldn't hear our kids. Sorry. It was great. We love it. Our kids love it. So
I rarely hear the noise in the stand. I think our kids are the same way. But that game, it got especially down the stretch.
Yeah,
it was so loud in that play, and even Colleen Ellison. I think it was just because
the Thunderdome. We were getting some AFs going up on that one. That were pretty good.
It got so loud in both of those games. It was pretty neat. You know, sometimes we have a beautiful arena, but sometimes it's almost a hindrance when it comes to a crowd because it's so wide open. And even when you have a decent crowd, it seems like nobody is ever there
except you guys.
We're
focused on the other teams.
Sometimes y'all wish we weren't. We're so close. Sorry about that.
We wear them out. Yeah. We even get some interaction from the bench players.
we've been called names before.
Yeah. And I've got to tell this one story because it's funny and you'll laugh. And I don't know who he's the JV coach for McKinney. The ball headed guy. And I don't know if y'all heard what I said to him, but it was actually one of these other guys said it.
Yeah, he did.
I wasn't there for the JV game, but he
never got off the bench.
And you were beating the snot out of him.
And he wouldn't say a word.
And then the varsity game started, and he was up and stomping around, la, la, la. And I finally got tired of it. I yelled at him. I said,
"Well, you sit down. You didn't coach that much during the JV game." And he
shut him down.
Oh,
he didn't say a word. He was embarrassed.
You didn't get the shush that Nolan got?
No.
That's Nolan got by a high plate umpire one time.
But yeah, it's fun to interact with those guys, especially when they do well with it. But you know, we're not. But anyhow, but yeah, the crowd I think started making a difference in Duncanville. I was surprised at the number of people that were down, you know, at Italy for that, and that was really cool. We were hauling butt to get to. We walked in as the national anthem was playing, so that was.
I think we ate a record time.
Whataburger.
Yeah. Double cheese from Whataburger.
It was a Whataburger.
Yeah.
It was Wah boom gone.
And so, you know, you beat Duncanville, you beat Ellison, you beat Crowley, and then the here beast is back.
Let's talk about the beast.
So we get, and I'm just going to say, we get there, Alan and I, and my son was there, and David, we walk in, and we sit down on the front row, and the game starts, and they score first. And then they score again, and you look up, and it's 5-0, and you're like, and then all of a sudden we start to see what is happening, and we're like, huh. And I need to read this. Alan sent me a text today, and he told me to read it to you, and we're going to do that because it's – and he had two things he wanted to say, and the second one relates to Guy, but let me read the first one thing.
Hey, while you're queuing – you got it queued
up?
I
got it.
Yeah. Okay.
He goes, this is from Alan. He goes, some things you should share with the coaches, if you would. A turning moment for me was McKinney when he benched the starters for the rest of the game. I saw that he would sacrifice the game for the betterment of this team, and I love that he did that. We saw teams with better / more talented players. One by one, those teams went down because this year's team didn't have a quote-unquote star that other members bowed to. Coach took complete control of the team this year to keep the whole where they should be. In years past, there was a lead player. Oops, I'm sorry. Oh, my gosh, you just freaked out on me. There was a lead player.
You're having a good day with technology.
Technology.
That all the rest counted on. This year, they had to count on each other. Okay, here's point two. You're going to love this. The slowdown against Guyer was pure mad scientist. It was like Coach Mack wasn't afraid to go for it, you know? Like the guy who might have lost his physique a while back, but when he goes to the beach, he peels down to his Speedo, and he just parades up and down the shore and doesn't care what others think.
I just got a bad mental picture, and that's me.
So did we.
We talked to Coach Long after the game, and you could see the absolute hurt in his eyes.
For a trash can right now to throw up.
Justly, he thought he would sail through the playoffs and take state. Coach Mack's Speedo move of the century was the biggest risk I've ever seen, and I, for one, was so stinking proud and happy for him. He took the great chance, and he slew the beast. So there you go from Alan. And so y'all talked about it, the slowdown.
Yeah, I kept.
And John came up to me after the game and about put me in arrhythmia because he hit me so hard in the chest.
John tries to hurt people after wins.
What did I tell you after the Guyer game?
Took Dixon into the ladder after this.
Yeah, he did.
It was like Jalen Scott was bringing the ball up the court, and he's over on our side where we're sitting, and he's bouncing and keeps looking back at you, kind of like going, is this what we're doing? You know? And that's why I said,
and
how
so
did they buy into that?
For the guys that weren't here, first quarter comes, the end of the quarter, and it's 5-5. And I text them, and I said, it's 5-5. What?
I'm on the road, quarter. And I get this text from Mark, and he goes, 5-5, into one. I'm like, what the hell?
Well, the first text I got from you, I asked you, and you said it was 17-11 at half. I thought he, like, didn't get the rest of the text. And the first quarter. And he always gives our score first, and I'm like, so that means we're up 17-11, and I'm freaking out.
I think that may have been when I got on the old coach and started listening to the game, and I started doing play-by-play by text. Because half of us weren't there, and these guys weren't listening
and
to it.
And you
could
keep up with it via text because there was plenty of time to get that text before the next shot went up.
When the announcers said they haven't subbed a single player yet, I was like,
That was
the
other
third
thing.
Quarter? It's like, what?
Yeah.
Are you serious? And I texted these guys. They said, no. And then they said, yeah, they have it.
Yeah, because I send you the text saying, Alan always subs.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that was our thing, you know.
And again, we're sitting there and we're like, you know, 5-5, okay, is this going to hold up? You know, and then halftime comes and the buzz in the stands, you guys had it going on because everybody was like, this might work. You know? And we're like, well, let's hope so, but it's still Guyer. And, you know, they're very talented and it was very, and y'all have watched the tape, but it was great to be able to sit there and experience that as a fan because it was nothing like we'd ever seen before.
Experiencing their frustration. I mean, those guys were getting very frustrated.
Yeah.
I had one of my former assistants who was at that game actually text me today. He's just been pondering it for 2 weeks now. And he's like, so, it's out of the blue. He texts me, goes, so if you're Guyer, what do you do if you're on the other sideline? I kind of bantered back and forth with him for a while. And he's like, no, really? I mean, like, I said, well, what would you do? And he's like, I don't know.
Well, and it's interesting you say that because, again, we're friends with Coach Long. And after the game, he was out talking to, I guess, to his dad. And his wife was standing there. And he saw us and he came over. And we didn't even get to say a word. And the first thing out of his mouth was, I knew y'all were going to play like that. And I thought to myself, was like, okay, if you knew we were going to play like that, why didn't you? Because to me, and again, at least for the whole first half, it didn't appear that they had any answer. They weren't coming out and challenging your guards. You know, they weren't putting pressure on the ball. So you were able to stand out there and do what you did. Now, maybe I'm wrong.
What made them really, really good all year and in against most everybody made them the way when they had to play different with those guys against us, like those bigs were really good when they could be bigs, but when they had to be essentially guards and guard guards, that was really tough on them. And, you know, you can't take three guys that are Division I basketball players off the floor in a regional tournament game. Right. But that's probably the best answer he had was to put his best five guards out there. But he, you know, you can't do that. And so
he never did.
And so, well, no, it was kind of a double edged sword for him. He didn't really have when you're that big, you don't have an answer for quickness.
He went small, but I think the thing that for them was there had been, I want to say, 4 or 5 games that they had played where teams didn't necessarily try to sell out the way we sold out in terms of the pace, but there were 4 or 5 games where teams did say, you know what, let's be patient and let's pull the ball out and, you know, let's see if that's our best option. And Guyer was able to turn them over. Mm-hmm. They were able to use their length, their size. They were able to do some trapping at half court and they were able to turn it over, get a 5-point lead, get a 6-point lead, and then get them out of that. We were just way better than those 4 teams that they played that were able to do that.
Well, I didn't get to see the game, but I'm thinking in my mind as they're probably putting way more value on each possession that they do get, and that trigger finger could have been just a little unsteady.
That was all part of it. That was all part of it.
What's going through their mind and putting the ball through the hoop is we got to score every time we touch it because we're not going to get to touch it much.
We knew going into it what we had to do is or what we felt was going to be the way to do it as coaches. Now, that's easy for us to say.
Right.
The hard sell was getting the kids to believe it, but it goes back to what we did at Colleen Ellison. You know,
and what we did at the end of North Crowley.
End of North Crowley.
The second half of the Guyer game at Guyer.
Yeah, I mean, so we had what was the plan? It was convincing the kids that was the right way, and I called in those 5 starters that morning, and we started laying seats.
In the Dallas morning.
We were planting seats the night before. We're sitting there in the bleachers, and Permian did a pretty good job of being patient methodical, but they shot bad shots after they were patient methodical. And we're up there planting seeds, and our guy's head's like, man, that would be great.
I got to sit with Jarrett Dixon for that whole first half of the Permian game, and I'm just sitting there with him, and I'm not – and, of course, me, like, I know what we had coaches had already discussed. And Jeff had said, well, I got – you know, I'm going to meet with the kids. So I'm not saying, hey, if we do this, right? But he's just watching the game, and he's saying, man, you know what? If Permian would, you know, take better shots, this kind of hold the ball, move the round thing, like – they could be winning this game.
Yeah.
And he kept making comments like that, and I kept going like, yeah. That's pretty accurate. And, you know, and so I felt like JD, who, you know, JD was, he has a lot of pull in our locker room in terms of, like, his thoughts carry a lot of weight. He's not necessarily our emotional leader, but he has a lot of pull. And right then when I heard him saying those things, I was like, man, like if he's going to buy in, you know, I think maybe we'd be able to get this thing going.
So we left it alone that night, but I called the five starters in and sold it a couple of different ways and put the spin on it to, you know, and we felt like if we could get one of their bigs off the floor, and that's the way we sold it, if we can get one of their bigs off the floor, make them have to play somebody defensively, and if I can keep the two Jaylens on the floor the whole game to match up with the other two bigs, but if we had to go to our bench against those other two bigs, we were in trouble. And I said, if we play an 80-possession game, you two guys are going to get in foul trouble versus these guys. It's just going to happen. The only way we're going to prevent that is if we make it a 40-possession game and we make them get out of their comfort zone and we get one of the 6-8s off that we can't match up with and leave you two guys on the floor for 32 minutes. And, you know, there was a lot of other spin and talk right. about it. And I said, look, I think it's the way to do it, but if you guys don't think it's the way to do it, it ain't going to work. So and before I could even finish, Jared Dixon goes, we're doing it.
That's awesome.
And
that's awesome.
I said, everybody else, and they're out there like, yeah, we're in. We're all in. And we didn't tell the rest of the guys until we got there before we started our shoot around that day. And it was pretty funny because we wanted to prep them.
Some emails.
We were preparing them. Not that we want to try to keep these guys on the floor, but we wanted to know, hey, we're going to hold it a little bit. And we weren't trying to hold it for 3 minutes. We were going to hold it long until they would come out and give right. us an advantage. And then we were going to take advantage or get them into some kind of zone trap thing where they turn somebody loose and we get wide open threes. We said we'll take layups and wide open threes. Every wide open three we were going to take. Every layup we were going to take. We weren't trying to run.
And we were still doing 4-second transition. We had, I think we
probably
had
a third of our points.
That's yeah. where we built our lead.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, if you go back and look at the game, there so much gets made on the offensive end. And yeah, it was a drastic, you know, offensive plan. But our guys were better defensively in that game than they had been in any other game against them. We turned their point guard over.
They turned
multiple
it over
times.
9 times out of their first 17 and, possessions. And that's what, scoring on the first 2 or 3.
If we don't get the defensive stops and we rebounded at us, I think right. I looked, it was 78% yeah. defensive rebound percentage. We hadn't been anywhere close to that against
them. Well, and nobody does it.
And nobody does. And so we out rebounded
like
them.
37%.
They shot 33% was the actual.
That was the other part.
So we were able to rebound and then. Those turnovers and runouts on rebounds and things like that that we're able to get were what got us the lead. And when you get that lead, that style's so much better. Yeah. And then, like we talked about the pressure, when you have to score with pressure, knowing that if you don't make this shot, it's going to be maybe 3 more minutes before you get another one, that is hard to do, especially when you're supposed to win state and you're supposed to have won state yeah. start the season.
Yeah.
That pressure is so tough on kids. Yeah, so
we same pressure our football team.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. yeah.
What's funny is when we went into the shoot around, we told the kids, and we were just trying to prepare them because, hey, the boos are coming. People are going to boo yeah. you. It is good. Your own parents. We told them, your own parents are going to start. We told them. I told them.
The Balding Eagles.
The Balding Eagles are going to start. They're going to go sit on the Geyer sign.
Each other, let's go.
And it's going to be, you know, you're going to be hated for a quarter. It's going to be ugly. And Carson Burt, one of our bench guys, it is amazing. He just walks out in the middle of all our guys. You know, everybody's kind of like serious. He goes, mwah, 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 we're eating booze for dinner tonight. Bring it on. He's like, bring it on. And all our guys just started going nuts. And this is before we even start kind of our walkthrough shoot around. And I thought, awesome, okay, man. they're all in. And that's then awesome. They come out the first 2 or 3 possessions, and we're down 5-0. And I'm like, oh, crap.
yeah, we were too.
This worked. It sounded really indeed, good earlier.
The other thing we had to do in that game that was just, I mean, I was kind of worried about, is we basically said, okay, JD and Isaiah, they're going to put their two best defenders on you who are really good. When Davion and Chris Craig and Darth are, those are their three best defenders. When they decide they're going to defend, they're as good as anybody in the state. And so we told our two best ball handlers, like, hey, just kind of like hang out. And if they're not going to let you catch the ball, don't catch the ball. So our 3, 4, and 5 were our ball handlers.
And curl all day long and make those big.
Our 1 and 2 who had handled the ball for us the entire year, they were not our playmakers. And so that was weird too. But again, you know, and I think that's part of what you said, Jay Scott, like looking back at the bench, like, what do I do?
We told them we were going to run like 30 or 40 seconds. And then we were probably going to call a set. And I think the first possession, we were about 2 minutes and 40 seconds in. I think that's when Jalen Scott was like, I thought we were going to call it set. All right, now this is working real well for us.
Gene Hackman and Hoosiers, four passes before you shift. Yeah. Well, 4 minutes before we call it set.
Well, at the end of the day, as shocking as it was really fun to watch, and it was really fun to be part of, to see that happen, yes, because it was. It was taking down the Giant, and it was to see their frustration. Not only the players, but their coaches too, because they didn't have an answer for it.
That's one of the other things. The guy that texted me today, he goes, when did you know it was going to work? And I said, well, towards the end of the first quarter, we came back and made it 5-5.
Mm-hmm.
And their coaches are up. The assistant coach is barking at the head coach to make a change defensively and do something different. We're the better team. You know, we got to do this, we got to do that. And he's kind of turning around barking at him. And the whole time we're sitting down there eating jelly beans. And I really went into that game like, I'm going to try to be the like most confident guy of all time here. And my assistant coach goes, I was looking at my old assistant coach. It's like, I was looking at you and y'all were down 5-0. And you like you kept telling you guys, awesome, this is what, perfect. This is what we wanted. He's like, you're down 5-0. He goes, how long are we going to go? I go, well, if we probably got to 8-0, it's probably going to be switch press the rest of the game. We're going to turn it loose. We were probably about one three-pointer away from scrapping that game plan.
Well, and you had to play an extra 10 seconds, too.
Yes, we did.
Which almost got me kicked out of the arena. But
a bust of blood vessel.
Because I heard the official come back and said, we're going to leave it like it was. I'm like, what are they doing? I mean, I don't know how y'all deal with that, because that just drives me insane, because it's...
Officials are human, but in the regional tournament, there is an extra official at the table.
I know it.
That's the thing that was frustrating.
They came down like every 2 minutes to tell our bench to sit down.
Yeah, I saw that.
Hey, watch, do your job over there on the clock. Let our kids cheer and have some fun.
It's so frustrating when it's an obvious error like that. And
we'll leave it like it is.
The extra 10 seconds. But I mean, the other thing was just with that pace, we felt like one of the things their kids, with all those elite star players, they all wanted touches.
Mm.
And I think they really started to – our defense was good, but they all started trying to do too much and too quick, and they quit pounding the ball inside and just –
They took shots out of rhythm, which gave us a better rebounding opportunity because the other guys aren't crashing at the same rate.
We didn't necessarily hear it, but our kids said that they were barking at each other, which we hadn't seen.
Totally out of their comfort zone, and when you get them barking at each other.
They'd lost one game all year. They weren't used to, one, being behind very much, and two, losing for sure. You know, and so and that game was it Waxahachie they lost to? Yeah, early in the year.
Yeah,
in the tournament.
But, man, they were so freaking good, man.
Oh, they are.
I don't know how it happens.
And I told Coach Long that afterwards. I said, you know what? You got a lot to be proud of because I can't explain it. You may not. It may take you a while to understand what happened to you today. But
basketball's a game of nights. If we did that 10 times, it may have only worked one. But it happened on the right night for us. And everybody's calling me the math scientist genius. But the kids went out and did it. And
well, exactly.
If we would have lost, everybody would have booed me and run me out of town. I would have got another anonymous email from the BEBC.
I'd let somebody else write that one. I don't want to get too consistent. So you get state, and here you go, and you got Westlake. And here's the thing: I can tell you, all of Allen Eagle Nation was like, "Okay, what are we going to see?"
Oh God!
Yeah. Because here you go with Westlake with almost a 7-footer and a couple 6'8" guys. And
the really
all...
cool thing is, I think Westlake was doing the same thing. Which Allen are we going to see? And so they had plenty of time to prepare for us, but they had to prepare for us doing things that we hadn't done all year from the Geyer game. But then they also had to think, well, but they've done this every other game. Will they do this? So I think it actually worked at our advantage, to be honest.
I had to I don't know. I liked our matchup against Westlake. He was a little – I don't know. You were a little hesitant at first. I think, you know, we had so much success what we had done against Ellison and Geyer. But these were two different teams than Westlake, and so I don't think all of us were on the same page with what our game plan was going to be with Westlake until the day of scouting report, where we finally kind of got on the same page with, because
we bounced around some ideas, and you know we were methodical, but it wasn't the same way we were methodical against, and it wasn't the same plan as it was against Geyer, and he had convinced me. I was like, oh man, our kids got so much confidence in running this passing game stuff we did against Geyer. You know, why go away from it? And there was another deal we called chin action, which was similar, but went about it a little bit different way, with still being methodical and getting the matchup we wanted, but it had better spacing for us. And so I think we finally went in there with that right idea. But you know, we played fast at times. We pressed a little bit that game. It wasn't the same thing. They got a little bit of everything that game.
And the cool thing that our kids, I think, took from from the guy game, that game, was taking great looks. We did it differently, but our kids took great looks against Westlake. And we didn't, it wasn't necessarily part of the game plan to do what we did against Skyer, but our kids had that kind of ingrained in them that if we take great looks, we're going to win this game.
We,
you know?
we said in that game again, layups are wide open three. We're not going to settle for contested shots at the rim versus the 6'11", 6'8", 6'7", 6'5", all big-time D1 guys.
Yeah.
But we also thought we could play a little bit fast against them because they didn't have a bench.
But yeah, the reason we weren't going to settle for that is because we didn't feel like we needed to. Like, yeah, we felt like we were going to get a layup or wide open three.
Well, the announcer in the championship game he gave the stat of what Allen shot in the second, what we shot in the second half.
13-14.
And, you know, he goes, you know, pretty much, you know, you got to, those are all good shots. Yeah. You know, when you take good shots, you
hit. Well, the one miss was a end of quarter heave that actually went halfway down.
With 1 second. Yeah. Desperation. Yeah. But, that was the highest field goal percentage for the largest classification in state tournament history and the largest highest three-point percentage for, against a team that had all the guys that they had and just.
And that's a team that also.
Allen set a record. I don't remember.
Yeah. That's a team that also was putting up a ton of points on their schedule. And we kept the game plan simple defensively. I mean, Joe was like, hey, we're not going to let this guy catch in the high post. And I was like, let's just try and speed up the guards. And, you know, we knew 50 was really good. And we were like, we're not going to be able to stop 50. Let's just try and stop the other guys from getting it to him. That's pretty much it.
Yeah. And we traditionally, we're good against low post players because our guys are used to, we front the post and we play behind it and we just do a lot of that stuff that makes it difficult. But we were exceptionally good, I thought, in this game of not letting the ball go to the high post, which is where they wanted to go. And we took a couple of charges on the big guy, got him out of the game. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, that was our bench. And Jay Scott was great. You know, just, you know, we, in that game,
once it got to six in the third quarter, it's like our kids were like, "This thing's over."
Yeah, because they knew they could guard.
Is that where the quote came from?
What's that?
And your quote, your pregame quote for the, if we get you down by six, that's it. Is that what the
kids told you that? Yeah, we had a watching party here for that, and we were off the couch quite a bit on that.
Well, lost the threes. Frustrated Westlake too, the defense, and then just how good our looks were because I know a lot of the stuff that was written afterwards, they're like, our tallest guy would have been their fourth or fifth tallest guy.
Yeah.
But yet they shot like double digit more 3-point attempts than we. Why weren't they just pounded it inside? But they couldn't.
Yep.
So they just put up.
Well, I fully expected that open three-pointer at the end that could have won it. I was thinking that was going in. I mean, that was a
talking about the championship game. Well, and the guy that, I mean, he doesn't really go under the radar because he does it every night. But Jalen Scott and then Donovan, from a defensive standpoint, really allowed us to dig in against some of those guys too. And you know, they don't get as much, you know, if you put up points, you know, against Donovan scored their game winner, so he got a lot of pub. But in that game they were just grinding, and those two guys would grind all year long, and you know, that's the kind of guys they are.
I had a lot of times I thought, man, Donovan's in that guy's jersey. I mean, he would put up against those.
And Donovan would be against a 6'8 guy.
He took his jersey.
He would get up against, and as soon as the guy moved, I mean, it's going to knock him backward, you know. But to have that grit, determination, and the willingness to get your head knocked on the floor, you know, those two guys,
Jalen Scott, you know, going into the season, we said we were going to be really good offensively, but those two guys just gritty, top finesse, and just set the tone for us. And I'll say, unsung heroes for sure.
I've never coached a better on ball defender than Donovan Parr.
Yeah.
And I've been doing it half as much time as these guys, but I've never coached a better on ball defender than him. He's special, 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 special.
Yeah, he. Well, I called him Dwayne from Rerun. I mean, what's happening?
You got a lot of names for a lot of people.
But he was, man. He just, his feet never stopped moving until it's time to take a charge, you know. Yeah.
And, man, our kids hated going up against him in practice.
I'm sure. Back to last year when he was on the JV.
You know, hate him, yeah. He made a lot of
wanted to fight
mad.
Him many days. Because he just makes your whole life miserable for the entire practice.
Yep. So you get to the championship game and it's like, wow, and here we are, you know, and you know, second time around, I guess, to be down at the state tournament, and it's probably a little bit different team, obviously. Yep. And I'll be honest, from I go back to the McKinney game, and we Alan and I talked about it because
let it go.
No, it'll stick with you forever. It's just like
28-minute mark. Move on.
Who would have thought? After seeing that this is where they'd be, and it's just like it's just a you know a compliment to you and the kids that you were able to come from, you know. And again, that was one game because that wasn't the season, but it was one game, and to find yourself in a championship game with no kid over what 6'6" on the team. And again, I know basketball's not all about height, and y'all proved that this year. But there you are, and you're like, okay, one more challenge, you know, against another very good team that's got a couple D1 commits on it.
Yeah, one of them's going to my favorite team, Georgia Tech, that Scholand.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the big kid.
When he could stay on the floor.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. He had a hard time in the
you know, and the enemy is just, you know, he's
dude, he had some awkward not walking travel, you know. It looked like he was walking, but he had some good.
Got to last night. I watched that one on Fox. It reran last night. That's the first time I've watched it since that. Since we actually played him, and I don't think many of them were. I was one to watch during the game. I started watching him.
Yeah,
the rerun. Like, man, he's just kind of special with his footwork there.
He had some different step. I mean, you don't call it a Euro step. But it was like it was hard to explain.
Different stride.
But yeah, a tough game back and forth. Yeah. I mean, it. You know, there were times, and that Nolan was the only one of us that got to go. I made plans with my wife when I was out of town, but I was watching on my tablet, you know.
That was tough for us because we don't get a chance to do a full scouting report. Because, I mean, sure. You're turning around and playing them the next day. No, we had been watching them all week, and they were my scout, and so I'd been watching them, but I kept watching them going, it's just like playing ourselves. These guys are a mm-hmm. lot like us. They do a lot of the same things. They're similar, and it was hard to figure out because in the whole playoffs, we'd found guys we could exploit. And they didn't have as many of those guys. Mm-hmm. The guy going to Georgia Tech ended up being the guy that we could exploit a little bit.
Yeah.
What number was he?
32.
Well, he 32. Couldn't match up out on the wing.
Yeah. Right. That's what it was, just the matchup.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And he was more of a perimeter shooter than he was anything else.
Yeah. He was the president.
He's a real good shooter.
He was 13. He would foul a lot. The white James Harden on it.
Kitty. 13? I forget that one. That
13
one.
Was a light-skinned, kind of stocky kid.
Yeah. Washington.
CJ Washington. He was tough.
Yeah, he's a tough kid.
And they said he didn't have a D1 offer.
He does now. Okay.
San Jose State. That's
good for him.
He's tough as nails.
Yeah. He was tough.
We went into that game, and we watched probably 10 games of him on film, and they played a lot of softer man and about 50% zone. And so we spent our day working on some softer man zone, trying to get some matchups, and they come out there. And they're pressuring the dog out of us and switching everything. And we were off balance for about a quarter and a half before we kind of like, whoa. What?
Well, that's the thing that stinks about having a, you know, 24-hour turnaround for the championship game.
I would love to see him do that to football one time. I just see football coaches football guys who spend, what, 12, you know, all day Saturday, all day Sunday. Yeah. And then they got a full week just, hey, try to do this. 24 hours later.
Sure. We didn't get to scheme anything offensively, which, you know, you want to find a way to get like two or three or four automatic buckets in the game each time you go up against an opponent. And we can't do that in 24 hours. But on the flip side, they couldn't either. Yeah. We saw their pregame and they had their they videoed their pregame
and put it on
and like put our scouting report up there. And it was pretty all over the place, like not real accurate.
And it was, generic.
I wish you would have 48 hours at least prepare for the championship game. But
well, there was the matchup, like who with our team is like who was going to be that guy, and mm-hmm. you know they had to know that there were all five of them could be that guy, and so it was hard for them. Like you said, it was hard for them to prepare.
That's what made us. I mean, the radio people from Guyer asked me before our game because Jeff was busy and. He was asking for stats and scouting report because they were, and I was like, honestly, dude, we got five guys that are all about 12 to 13 points, and any one of them can score 20, and any one of them score 5. So just do what you want with that.
and that's the truth.
They all can shoot the three, they all can shoot free throws. And,
yeah. You know, so,
deal with it.
You know, that's.
Deal with it.
You know, and in that game, you know, JD, our senior who had played the most minutes of any varsity player in our program, played on varsity as a freshman, you know, and he knows that he had one of his worst games he's ever played.
Yeah. He also drew their probably best defender.
Yes, they were going to lock him down. And we told him that at halftime, like, hey, they're trying to take you out. And we still found a way to win. I mean, yep. A guy that, you know, we count on JD night in, night out, and they took him out of the game. And, you know, his teammates picked him up. And so, I mean, that was what made us so hard to guard all year.
That was evident in the stands because people were talking. It was like, I mean, JD, he's got 2 points.
Yeah.
You know, he's got 2 points.
But, I mean, we've had other guys that happened to this year. You know, there would be a game early in the season, Jalen Walker would have a couple of three-point, two-point games, and he couldn't get going, but we still were winning games, you know. So.
You know, the thing that was impressive for me being at that game so far, and people were saying, we're talking
that was his one game he went to all year.
No, that was not the one game.
I think it was a good one to go to.
Yeah.
I'm just glad you were there. Game.
Well, we shot a high percentage of free throws.
They did.
We didn't shoot many, but we shot.
Okay, can I finish?
Yes.
So the thing that I was real impressed, you know, and I had been to a few games before. Travel, by the way, got me about most of the year. But, you know, there were times when you felt like, okay, Allen's in a little slump. But your guys never let Katie get that far ahead. Even though they were having a little off period right here, you know, and then all of a sudden, oh, we're back, and then boom, 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 back to a tie game, just like that. And that was consistent throughout the entire game. I mean, it was frustrating from a fan's perspective that Allen could never get ahead or hold a lead, you know, too far. But the thing about, because it was definitely something different than been going on all year, except for but it, you know, the thing, but,
go ahead.
But the thing, you know, it was just the thing that I took away from that game was just how impressive it was that even though the boy, you know, there's always ups and downs during the game, but even though the downs, you know, some of the downs can get pretty severe, but they just never let them take advantage of it. And that was the one thing that that people were talking about in the stands going, you know what, they may not be making it, you know, because like you said, JD was having an off night that game. And, you know, there'd be 2-3 possessions, right, you know, kind of backed it. He wasn't hitting shots. He wasn't making shots. And so it was perfect opportunity for Katie to go up 6, 7, 8 points.
Yeah, but in the midst of that.
Wasn't the largest lead, 8 points?
Yeah.
Yeah.
In the midst of that, though, I think a microcosm of us, our season, our locker room. I don't know if you remember this moment, but there's a moment in the third quarter where there was a loose ball and JD sprints from the free throw line and dives head first.
Which was not his MO.
And he would be the first one to say, as a freshman, sophomore, or junior, I struggled to make that play. But he was willing to do whatever it took to win that game. And they believed in each other. They trusted each other.
That was down on their end of the court.
Yep.
And I remember, and they ended up being a scramble, and then their guy went over Jalen Scott's back, right?
Yep.
I think that was at the same time frame.
And I think they may have gotten the ball out of bounds on that. But, you know, just that play, you know, I think they it just showed what they were willing to do to win the game, how much they trusted each other. JD didn't care that he was, you know, having a bad game. It may have bothered him a little bit, but he just wanted to win, you know. Mm-hmm. And his teammates trusted him.
You know, we got those guys that are gritty, that embrace that grind, Jalen Scott, Donovan, and all of them were kind of, you know, they were all laying on the line. But those two guys, you know, did that kind of stuff all year. And so we just had to rely on some grit just to get through. So, you know, we went at halftime down 3, and as we walked in, we're like, we're playing not anywhere close to what we played in the playoffs, and we're down 3.
That was what we were saying. Like, we're not even playing anywhere close to what these guys, and we're only down 3.
So we just tried to grind one out. Yeah. We talked about that all the time. You know, we have to grind, you know, during stretch of games, you have to grind it out.
We went into the second half, and we made some runs. And it seemed like every time we were about to, like, take control, bam, they hit a 3 right behind. Like, we've gotten back ahead. We've taken about a 2-point lead. Bam, they knocked out a 3 on the other end. But our kids just kept coming back.
That was the impressive thing.
The paper said 13 lead changes, and Allen led for 5 minutes and 53 seconds of the 36 minutes played.
And it comes down to the end of regulation, and you,
Jalen had a great look at a three.
We all thought it was it.
His stroke looked really good that night. I'll tell you that. He looked very calm.
Thought Jay Scott was going to score that one on the block, if you remember, and he missed it. But he got his own rebound. Just like he would do.
The guy got the rebound and tried to save it.
Yeah. Oh, is that what happened?
He saved it right to Jay Walker.
He kicked it to Jay Walker.
He could have forced a contested look, but the way we've been playing, he kicks it up for the wide open three.
Because his back was...
We all thought that. It was right on line. It was on line. We all thought we were winning this at regulation.
Yeah, it hit the back of the rim.
Yeah.
I thought it went back and it hit the other side a little bit and came out. I don't know.
But I think that for me, I'll just say it's fitting it ended the way it did, because that sequence of plays will live in infamy for us and for those who witnessed it, and for Jalen for his defense, for Walker for the kick out, and for Farm to be able to make that layup. We will always remember that play.
When that guy went behind his back to go back to the middle, I thought to myself right then, that was a mistake. He went right into the teeth of the defense.
There were a lot of people in the lane. I know it was crowded down there. And they sold out for an offensive rebound.
Yeah, they did.
That's exactly what they did.
And one guy, and their point guard stood. The other four sold out. The point guard, they put him in the corner for a kick out three, and he watched. And it was too late by the time.
And lost in all of it is that Donovan Parham did not block out on that play.
or Isaiah Stevens, who was running right next to him.
But it is. It will be. And I'm going to just say this to y'all, and I tweeted this after the Geyer game, that I've been watching Allen Sports since 1995, and y'all's coaching job for the Geyer game was the best coaching job of any sport that I had seen since 1995.
The best kids' execution job.
That, too. It
takes both.
We draw it up a lot of times, and it doesn't come out the way we expect.
For us, you'll get an A-plus for the year. We'll give you that. Despite what happened.
First ever A-plus this year.
Yeah, we don't give many
of
those.
You from the McKinney game?
You
brought that back up now.
Thank God pencils have a racer.
Yeah. You redeemed yourself. I'll say that. And again, I'm like your wife. I like the emotion from that game. We were talking about that for weeks.
That was awesome.
What was he so mad about? Well, I have to show you. I brought this for you guys to try on, take a picture with. You guys are our biggest fans, so I wanted you to get a picture with one of these.
Look at that.
Pass it around and get yourself a pic.
That's cool.
Is there a design for the rings yet? That is happening tomorrow at 11.
Wow. Look at you. Great. You want your picture made with it?
Isn't it?
No. All right. And I just want to take, again, congrats on a great year. Let's talk JV for a minute, because y'all were awesome this year, too. And you guys, as freshmen, I mean, what was your final record this year?
Oh, shoot.
Oh, he doesn't know. It doesn't matter, right?
21-2, something like that.
And a great group of kids.
Yes. Yeah. Great group of kids. Way different from the group we had last year.
He chuckles as he says that.
Yeah, well, the group we had last year, so Donovan and J-Rock and cameraman, that group was easy. Corey, that group was so easy to coach. They coached themselves. They played hard.
Juniors on JV that
year. Yeah. this group was a group that we had to coach a lot. They were a fun group to coach, and I think that they – surprised us. They exceeded our expectations for them, which is a credit to those kids. And we had a similar moment to the McKinney game, I guess.
We missed that one.
Just in terms of point of the year where you feel like the ship is just going. And we had I met with some of the guys and just told them how things needed to change, and they kind of took control of the locker room. But it was a good year.
Good life lessons.
Any
height?
No.
Basketball?
It doesn't happen. What would we do with Allen? They wouldn't know how to coach. We gotta go find
some homeschool.
He mentioned J Rock, Jordan Neely, and I think we skipped over that North Crowley game a little bit. We probably should have lost that North Crowley game but we made a sub with Jordan and maybe Corey Jones and Donovan. Those guys came in.
High energy.
J Rock, in about a 3 minute span, maybe even two, changed that game and changed the direction.
We went on a 7-0 run.
That goes unnoticed and all in the Geyer game and in the stuff that's state, but
you know, a guy like that who went through the JV, was a, you know, a junior on JV, and
stuck
and
with
just
the program.
Well, I mean, and just bought into his role and never made it about him. But when he got a chance, made plays.
In the locker room.
Yeah, it really was neat.
Well, it was cool to see. You mentioned Corey Jones. I've never seen somebody have so much energy. I mean, he every time he came in, it was 90 to nothing, like a jumping bean too.
For better or worse.
Yeah. And I know you look at it differently.
No,
yeah.
He's an energizer. Right?
Yeah.
He understood his role. Did a great. That's the thing with this group. It was amazing. From 1 to 12, yeah. Watching them give of themselves and serve each other and just buy into what their role was. Noah Dutzer at the end of the bench is maybe one of the greatest service kids I've ever been around, and just so into it. He's crying after the game when they got that trophy. I mean, he's balling. I mean, didn't play a lot of time all year long, but was invested just as much as every single guy. Mm-hmm. My nephew Charlie down there didn't see a lot of action. And
yeah, I was told to ask you when you were going to play him.
But he bought into the role, Cameron Mann, and just Carson Bird. Like, his role was to just be loud. Whenever our practices got kind of dull or stale, his job was just to say something totally off the wall. And just get guys laughing and give us some energy. And cameraman was the goofy guy that always just kind of.
Yeah, because his dad said he didn't know he was going to Pepperdine.
We didn't know either. And I asked him afterward, and he goes, yeah, I guess. And I was like,
I thought that was a total. So awesome. I was like, whatever. Some elementary kids asked him today where he's going. He goes, I don't know.
It changes.
Preston Elementary. He doesn't know where he's going today. So
yeah, but
Pepperdine was good. He had, like, so many times throughout the year, like, when we're back, and you could tell, like, we're backstage, and it's huge back there. They got the big black curtain, and you're in the back there, and the games go on forever. We had an overtime game before. So right. Your guys are a little bit tight. Cameraman just starts saying stuff and doing stuff, and immediately our guys are just loose. I look down in the other corner, and I see Westlake's guys. And you could tell they were just so tight.
Our guys were playing patty cake.
Yeah. Our guys were playing patty cake.
Dead serious.
Behind the scenes. Yeah,
it's just.
I think I tried. My biggest thing going into the playoffs is, like, I just want to be, like, the most calm, because I can get a little worked up sometimes. I'm just not going to let little things bother me. I'm just going to, like, you know, I'm going to. And we learned some. Important. We learned some mistakes probably the first time we went. We got caught up in a lot of the extra stuff, like the media stuff. And, you know, when we went in 2014,
yeah,
the hotels and all that kind of stuff.
You guys finished up already, didn't you?
Oh, no. Certainly. Say hello to the coaches, Alan. They're here.
We're still going.
At 9:05?
Yes.
Hello, Alan.
Well, we had some technical difficulties to get started, if the truth be known.
All right. Here's the thing. I read your little message to Jeff, and all he could do was picture himself.
Everybody started throwing up in trash cans. Everybody got a mental picture. It was bad.
You had to go there with Speedo, didn't you?
Yeah, well, you know. It's the visual that kills, man.
You're our first call-in caller ever on the podcast.
Can you do that on a podcast?
Doing the thing now, are you?
Yeah, man, this is going to be on it. That's awesome. How's Hawaii?
Well, there's nothing like a mechanical to slow everything down, you know what I mean?
Oh, so you have engine trouble.
You're not flying the plane right now, are you?
No, the blind guy's got it.
Well, anything you want to say or ask, they're here.
I'm sounding like James.
That's awesome, dude.
Hey, that's all I got. I was just calling to see how it went.
Oh, well, you know, it'll be up tomorrow. We will let you know that we did have our major discussion on the McKinney game with them. So you'll be interested in knowing the results of that.
We're not having a McKinney game.
Jeez. Because I know you left there.
We can fix that.
Don't want to create any spoilers or anything, but I got to let you know, we won state.
When did this happen?
While you were in the air somewhere.
I was watching the replay last night. I got a little nervous, I must say. End of the fourth quarter.
All I've got to say is, man, that one hand up in the air scooting down the sideline thing was a thing of beauty.
What do you have the 40 speed timed at over there? Because there's been some debate here.
Yeah, there's been a little controversy.
Uh-oh.
6'8".
I bet it's better than you. He didn't pull a hammy.
Yeah, I know. It still hurts thinking about it.
We participated in the
one time, the
wiffle ball thing tournament.
Oh, yep. One time.
Homeboy pulls a hammy running to first base. He's laying on the ground.
Help! He went down like somebody shot him.
Yeah.
He went down.
So, anyhow. But no questions? It's your opportunity.
No.
All right.
Not really. Just congrats, man. I mean, that was totally, at the beginning of the year, unexpected. But, like, going to the In-N-Out tournament thing and watching how well they worked together was just so great. And then, sitting in that McKinney game, thinking,
well, enough for this caller. Who do you have up next? He's about to hang
but
you.
But then, the tournament, the state tournament, sitting there watching, it's like, now this is the team that was the In-N-Out deal, yeah. And so I think it's great how y'all brought them back together as a team. That's what impressed me more than anything, is just that they were all playing so together, just... Everybody that went in played together. It was just that was magical.
Yeah,
we agree.
Dilly dilly.
Dilly dilly.
Hey, by the way, who's the chick in the background?
Who's what?
Who's the girl laughing in the background?
Oh, well, we're finally on the bus driving to the airport through Honolulu.
Oh. All right.
Trying to not run over the homeless people.
That was a vague answer, which you'll get out of him.
The party bus to the bar? What?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's just, this is a totally different place. The captain got a $72 ticket today because riding his bicycle, he didn't come to a complete stop at an intersection.
Thank God they enforced bike laws somewhere.
Yeah.
In this world.
You got to get your money where you can get it.
Yeah, I guess so. All right. Well.
All right, y'all. Peace out, man.
Safe.
Congrats again.
Thank you.
Safe trip, Al.
All right. Hey up.
There you go, our first call-in caller at any point in time. Well, now you know what you've done is you've raised the bar so high. Guess what expectations are for next year?
Beat McKinney.
Yeah.
What a night. Hey, I do have a question. Inquiring minds want to know, when are you ever going to break out the jacket, the shirt, and the tie?
Woo! Okay.
I mean, you're the reigning state champion.
He won't win.
We'll take you to the big and tall, brother.
No, let's not change things up here.
Yeah, can't change it up.
I tell you what, he'll wear that when Drew unbuttons his top button.
Who's wearing skinny jeans?
We noticed. True. Trust me, we noticed.
I was a suit and tie guy early on in my career.
Really?
Which, yeah. And, we sat down one year and we changed our philosophy to we played just kind of so tight and grinded everything. And we decided one year, we want to play loose and we want to play free and we want to get up and down and we want the kids to feel relaxed. And we're over here in a tie that we don't ever wear. And people know that. I mean, I'm no suit guy. if I do get a suit on, I ended up looking like Virginia Tech.
Buzz
Williams, just all sweaty and sloppy looking. by the end of the first quarter, he didn't look sloppy, but he gets all sweaty and it's all
Sean Miller.
Sean Archie Miller, Archie Miller. Yeah,
that was the Carter coach the game before.
So yeah. I learned a long time ago that's not for me. And let's just, if we want our kids to play loose and relaxed, we gotta present ourselves somewhat loose and relaxed.
Especially when you get to the
people brought up to me, the Tompkins coach wore polo on semifinal night, or a suit and tie the next night.
Yeah.
Changed it up.
Yeah, a lot of coaches will do that. They'll like all of a sudden start dressing up for the playoffs, which I think
I only
just
have one shirt I wear during the playoffs. One.
Yeah.
I do watch the game, so.
Yeah.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, for real. Well, again, we appreciate y'all coming out and
thank you.
Spending
thank
a you couple know. Hours.
Yeah,
with
I,
us.
I have one thing to say because I listened to y'all's last podcast.
Uh-oh. Oh, no.
All right. So I'm going to give you some. Pointer, okay, because this is the
coach.
Come on,
coach.
This is the most frustrating thing for a coach to hear from the stands. Follow your shot.
Oh.
Okay, listen.
Who was following your shot?
I don't say it.
Shooters do not follow their shot. Shooters finish. Shooters see their feet. Shooters follow through. Now, if you're shooting in the paint, okay, if you're in the painted area, yeah, go get your board. But if you are a jump shooter, okay, a pure shooter, and I can shoot the ball a little bit, you have got to see your shot go through. And it's all about rhythm. And so when you hear parents say that, now you can tell them to shut up.
I was going to send out an anonymous email to you. If you want to just call you out right in front of you.
Can't call me out. I don't say it.
But most people think that's what you're supposed to say.
Khalid Ellison still follows through with that.
But they've got a reason because they know it's going to miss.
Yeah.
No. Especially if you're shooting from the top of the key. I mean, you know, you're the first man that should be back. Yep. You know, that thing. But
so if you're shooting a three from the baseline, mm-hmm. What's the idea in terms of being able to get the rebound? You're thinking it's going to go in, but do you want to have some setup for the rebound on those types of shots?
Not from the guy shooting it.
Not from the guy shooting, but the other guy should be.
Now depending on some of those guys watched. And a lot of times this year we watched, you know, because
we did a lot of watching because we knocked down a lot of them too.
Yeah. But those guys shouldn't be watching. Those other guys. There's one guy getting back. Anyway,
that's a fair, and we appreciate the feedback. You taught us something tonight, so you won't hear that next year.
And you don't see. We'll come up with something else.
I never heard it this year.
You never heard.
We hear it because we're the only guys in the state. We know. Who did that come from?
It's
my mom and those guys.
And the other thing, I don't know. I can't remember who it was, but which one of you helped us win the McKinney Boyd game at Lowry? You know what I'm talking about? We lost our whiteboard, and we couldn't find it. The game where Miles Nesbitt hit a buzzer beater.
I do remember that game.
Okay, we lost our whiteboard. We couldn't find it. It was under the bleachers, and one of you guys went and found it.
Must have been Alan.
Yes. Probably Alan.
Okay. I never got a chance to think, because we were like, because these two guys were gone, right?
We were scouting. Yeah.
So it was just us two. And we're looking at each other like, where's the board?
Olin was out. Nick was out.
Yeah. And, you know, that was the play for the game winner. So, you guys, one of you guys came to the rescue.
Glad we can help.
Yeah. Hockey assist.
We don't offer much of anything, so I'm glad we could help.
Hey, and last one, shout out to your mentor. You knew he was down at the end of the floor?
I knew he was at the game. He had talked to me before. I had no idea he was sitting down there. I just got caught up in the moment. And
sprinted down there,
and I'm finger rolling, and I'm like, oh my, you know, of course I'm down there by myself all of a sudden. My team's about to run on the floor, and I'm just like, oh my goodness. And like, right, he just turns, like, there's pictures of him, like when Donnie's shooting a layup, just standing up, like right underneath the goal doing this. Wow. And then he turns around, and like it's like, oh, hey. He's starting to well up with tears, and like it was kind of like we didn't know if we were a high five in or hug, you know, bro hug in or dad. It was like an awkward moment, and then we realized there's 1.1 second. It was about to be. I was going to be some kind of Twitter meme or something.
The cool thing about that is John Williamson, the guy. He hired him for his first job. He hired me for my first job, and he hired him for his first job. So we're all
so really, he didn't hire me.
But he's only worked under us. So he's kind of like for
all of us. He's
got a cool name.
He's ground zero.
He's ground zero, the coaching tree, and for us, and that's awesome. Had such an influence. I think just as much as a man and a person and a father and a husband of how you do those things, as it is a coach too.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was pretty cool for him to share in that moment with us, and that brief moment that we had 1.1 second that lasted forever. and then we got to celebrate it again. So,
well, before we go, I put brackets in front of y'all. We're down to the Sweet 16.
Kentucky.
I know you're going to say Kentucky down there. Whatever. John says Kentucky because he's a Kentucky homer, and they do have a pretty easy road to the Final Four. I'll give them that.
Yeah. Play who's in front of you.
I understand. Whatever. Oh, I'm not saying it's their fault. Who's y'all's pick?
I'm taking Villanova, but I got a son there, so I can't. I got too much money going to Villanova
to pick anything else. Right?
I got to go with Nova.
So Joe goes with Villanova. John goes with Kentucky.
Duke for Thad.
I'm an ACC guy.
Yeah, I know.
Nobody's got the Red Raiders.
Yeah, but that's the best one.
I got Nova.
Drew, what do you think?
I think whoever wins the Nova West Virginia game is going to win it all.
Nova.
So I'm going to say West Virginia just because the other guys are
to be different. There you go.
Nova.
All right, big boss.
West Virginia.
All right, boss.
What whatever I say is going to be the kiss of death because I had Michigan State.
I know that feeling.
It,
I know that
over feeling. Arizona. Yeah, Michigan, so whatever you and I say, betting guys need to go opposite of that.
Say
Amen,
man, because we don't
say no.
That's the one team I do not want to see win.
Amen to that.
Bad Plano West blood there. so
it ain't going to happen. Don't worry.
We might have had another championship if it went for those Plano West.
We've played a lot of kids from these teams. Tech,
oh, yeah.
Tech has that's three guys we played.
Yep.
Purdue's got a kid. Obviously. Yeah.
Where did Mickey Mitchell go?
He's at Arizona State.
He's Arizona State now. He went to Ohio State
first. He
went
a couple other places first. Yeah. Kyle Pauley.
I'm going to kiss the death Villanova here.
Oh,
this reminds me a lot of us. They play smaller. Age. They play guards. They play together.
We'll follow up in a couple weeks on our next podcast and give kudos to whoever was right and make fun of whoever was wrong because that's how we roll. Again, guys, thank you very much for coming out. And again, from a great season, we're happy for y'all, happy for the kids.
Absolutely.
And glad y'all were the first to bring it to Allen in the basketball arena. So
thanks for having us.
Do it again, man. Do it again
next year. Yeah. And y'all are more than welcome to come out.
You bet. Y'all want to come out and hang with us? We're here. And if you have comments about football and want to come out and we do football podcast, feel free.
Well, now that I know you can call in.
Eric, you can do that. We'll give you a number. So. Thanks again. Well, folks, this has been a long one. We appreciate you hanging in there with us. And so until next time, it's over.